Praise the Lord. I am Reverend Pat Carroll, Dean of MITT, or Middlesex Institute of Theology and Technology. I am the instructor for this course, which is entitled The Pursuit of Excellence in Your Christian Walk. This particular module is entitled Coram Deo, or In the Presence of God. I ask that you follow along with your course outline, and where you see blanks, fill in those blanks. Feel free at any time to pause the video or rewind the video, whatever you need to do. But I really would encourage you to be actively involved in this teaching. All right. Coram Deo, or Deo, is a Latin phrase which can be translated in the presence of God. And it really summarizes the idea of Christian living in the presence of, under the authority of, and to the honor and glory of God. Actually, you know, this is really is a heart issue. During this lecture, when we use the expression Coram Deo, we will be recognizing the subject as a heart issue. Let us start with, we can only scratch the surface of what it really means. So I will address a few subtopics in this study of God to take us a little closer to the throne of grace. Indeed, Hebrews 4 and 13 bids us to come boldly to the throne of our gracious God, and there we will receive His mercy, and we will find grace to help when we need it the most. Let us begin with affirming the divine sovereignty of God. Our God remains incomprehensible, and He retains His simplicity at the same time. He tells us in His word that He is not a God of confusion, but of order. He is not at war with Himself. He was, is, and evermore will be a law unto Himself. He is altogether good, altogether holy, and altogether sovereign. This we must affirm to maintain a good biblical concept of the divine sovereignty. And yet we must also and always balance this understanding with a clear understanding that God is always exercises both His power, and this is where you would fill in the word power, and authority. Fill that in. According to His holy character. I'll repeat. God always exercises both His power and authority according to His holy character. This is something we can rest on, knowing that what He wishes for, and that He not only wishes to have these things for us, but He has the power to bring all good things for us, His children. The heart issue, or the Coram Deo, reaffirm your trust in the sovereignty of God, who is working all things together for His good pleasure. Fill in the blank, for His good pleasure. Amen. Let's go on to the second point. Trying to understand what it really means, the free will. And just to give a little background, Martin Luther was a monk in the late 1400s, early 1500s. He was a German theologian, an Augustinian monk, an ecclesiastical reformer whose teachings inspired the Reformation. And he deeply influenced doctrines and culture of the Lutheran and Protestant traditions. Luther's contributions to Western civilization went beyond the life of the Christian church. Luther's translations of the Bible helped to develop a standard version of the German language and added several principles to the art of translation. Luther's hymns inspired the development of congregational singing in Christianity. Even his marriage in 1525 to Katharina von Bora began a movement of clerical marriage within many Christian traditions. One might ask, well, Luther struggled greatly, I should say, with the relationship of God's sovereignty and human free will and sin, especially when we look at Old Testament passages where we read that God hardened Pharaoh's heart, and he did it not once but several times. So one might ask, well, doesn't this suggest that God not only works through the desires and actions of human, but he actually forces evil upon people? So we would ask you to fill in the word evil to finish that statement. And the phrase would then read, actions of humans, but he actually forces evil upon people. But before we go any further, let's look at the heart issue here, the Coram Deo. And we need to ask God, always keep our hearts soft and pliable to his divine will and purposes. So we're going to go further into this idea, understanding not so much the free will of man, but God's will. What is God's will? There are a few concepts in theology that generate more confusion than the will of God. The Bible uses the expression in various ways. One of those ways, we encounter at least two different Greek words in the New Testament, boule and thelemo, both of which are capable even themselves of several nuances. And here you have some blanks to fill in. The first one is, they encompass such ideas as the counsel of God. Counsel of God, C-O-U-N-S-E-L. Also, these words are defining God's will, encompasses the plan of God. God plans. The third point, God decrees. So God's will embraces his decrees. And fourth, the disposition of God. The disposition of God, as well as several other nuances. We do want to pause and look at scripture here. Psalm 40, verse 8 in the NIV reads, I desire to do your will, my God. Your law is within my heart. Psalm 143, verse 10 in the NIV, teach me to do your will, for you are my God. May your good spirit, and that's the Holy Spirit, lead me on level ground. And then Matthew 6, verse 10 in the NIV, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And that's always a very excellent prayer when we're not certain of what God's will is for our lives or at any particular time when we're faced with something. I know I use it frequently and just say, God, your kingdom come. Because, see, the kingdom of God is where he is sovereign. Righteousness, peace, joy in the Holy Ghost, the songwriter said, is the kingdom of God. And that's what we want on this earth. We want the kingdom of God. And we want his will to be done because we know that his ways is so much higher than our ways. Another point is, theologians give us at least three different renderings of the will of God. And number one, the decretive will of God. That's comprehending and or understanding the decretive will of God. D-E-C-R-E-T-I-V. That's also the sovereign will of God, whereby he brings to pass whatever he pleases by his divine decree. An example is creation, when God said, "Let there be light." The decretive will of God can have no other effect, no other consequence than what God sovereignly commands. There is no wiggle room when God decrees. A second point or rendering would be the perceptive. That's the perceptive, P-E-R-C-E-P-T-I-V-E, will of God. And this relates to the revealed commandments of God's published law. This decree, it doesn't carry with it an immediate necessity or consequence, but it is possible it does for us to refuse, and we can actually refuse to obey his commands. We know that. We have the power. However, we don't have the power to disobey it with impunity. With impunity, I-M-P-U-N-I-T-Y, which means disobedience will incur a type of punishment. And so we cannot annul it, which means we can't say we don't really want to follow that law because we don't think it's right, we don't agree with it or whatever. But if God has decreed it, it is what it is. His law remains intact whether we obey or not. It doesn't change according to how we feel about it. A third point, when we expose, and it's up to us, certainly as students of the Word of God, to expose what the world calls the permissive will of God. That has just gotten so much play in the last several years, and it's just gotten way out of line. When we say that God allows or permits evil, it doesn't mean that he approves of it. God never permits sin in the sense that he puts his stamp of approval. And that's your fill in the blank there. The word, first word is approval. The second blank is his stamp of approval on it for his creatures. And then we talk about, and this is where we come to divine permission, that God simply lets it happen, please. That is that he does not directly intervene to prevent it from happening. Some theologies view this drama as if God were impotent, to do anything about human sin. This view makes man sovereign with and not God. This view says that God permits what he cannot help, that he does not have sovereign power over it. This boils down to pure, unvarnished atheism. Intellectually, we can search scriptures to rightly divide the various forms of God's will. But you know, it really is a Coram Deo frame of reference, a tangible visitation of the Spirit of God, where we can gain insight into the heart of God, a place that surpasses our ability to express even in words that experience. I shared with you now an article that I have read from Pastor Jack Hayford out in California, and he shared with us an occasion where he actually experienced the tangible presence of God, when the face of God was up close and personal. He writes, "It happened the first Saturday in 1971 on a chilly but crystal clear Southern California day. I had just finished preparing for the Sunday morning service, and with Bible and notes in hand, I was standing in the church prayer chapel. I was not there to pray. My mission was much more mundane. I just wanted to adjust the temperature on the thermostat, he says. Actually, I was utterly unaware that I was about to experience one of the most miraculous moments of my life. I finished my business with the thermostat and turned to head for the door. As I did, what met my eyes was a sight I was in no way prepared to see. It was something I didn't talk about for years, and even now, only I tell it for a very specific purpose. The room was filled with a visible silver mist. Oh, I stared in amazement, knowing what it appeared to be. I read in the Bible about the cloud-like manifestation of the glory of God, of the Lord. I had heard people talk about the Shekinah glory of his presence, but I had never expected to see it myself. The very thought seemed so pretentious, I was afraid to let it settle in my mind, Jack writes. Stepping out of the chapel into another room, I rubbed my eyes. Then I went back in, only to find the mist was still there. As I gazed at it once again in astonishment, I heard the Lord clearly speak inside of me. He said, "It is what you think it is." He said, "I have given my glory to dwell in this place." You know, sometimes people ask me what I did. They said, "Did you pray?" They said, "Did you fall on your face and cry hallelujah? Did you carve something on the altar?" And I said, "No, no, no." As unspiritual as it may sound, I didn't. I simply watched, thanking the Lord over and over as the mist gradually dissipated. When I couldn't see it anymore, I walked out of the door and went home. The next morning in church, although nothing out of place happened, nothing unusual, it became clear that we had passed a sacred spiritual milestone. Instead of the usual 100 people, 170 showed up for the service. And from then on, year after year, they kept coming. First by the hundreds, then by the thousands. The church began growing and never stopped. I am thankful to be a part of all this, Dr. Hayford says. However, I am also keenly aware that none of it is due to any particular accomplishment on my behalf. I am not special or remarkable in any way. I am simply a case study of God at work in someone's life. I'm just an example of what can happen when you're in the midst of a place where God's glory comes to dwell. This is the reason I tell my story, because God didn't intend for it to be unique. The gift of his glory is not preserved exclusively for certain people in certain regions. According to Isaiah 4 and 5, the Bible reads, "The Lord Jehovah will create upon every dwelling place of Mount Zion and upon her assemblies a cloud and smoke by day and the shining of a flaming fire by night. For upon all the glory shall be a defense." In other words, God desires for his glory to be every place where God's people dwell. He wants his glory to be in your home, in your car, as you drive to work. He wants it to envelop you, much like the fire of the Holy Spirit enveloped the early disciples on the day of Pentecost, and abide with you always, every day of your life. So how do we exactly make room for God's glory? And there are four phrases here and four blanks. The first, by walking in obedience to the Lord and surrendering to his will. That is walking in obedience to the Lord and surrendering to His will. Second point, worship. Worship Him daily. The third point, by listening to His voice. That's how we make room for God's glory. We listen for His voice and to His voice and feed upon His word is the fourth point. This is how we make room and invite, make it a place of invitation for God's glory. We kneel and pray. We raise our hands to Him in the morning when we rise. We sing His praises. We acknowledge our devotion and say, Lord, I need You today. As we do such things, not as a duty, but with reverence from our heart, we experience His presence. We are changed into His likeness from one degree of glory to another. So I want to encourage you in your pursuit of excellence in this Christian walk. If you're not doing it already, invest that time every day, worshiping and fellowshipping with the Lord. I realize that's not always easy because of our busy, noisy culture, but it's crucial because we all need His glory in our lives to fulfill our calling as a believer. We need to be refreshed and strengthened by God's presence every day because our call is just as lifelong as anyone else's and just as precious to God. God's on the move, people, just as He was on that forgettable day in 1971. For all of us in God's kingdom, there are milestone times. I believe in eternity to come, we will look back and say, oh, look what the Lord has done. So we conclude with Coram Deo, in the presence of God, in the face of God. Psalm 31:3 says, since You are my rock and my fortress, for the sake of Your name, lead, guide me. Psalm 139:8-10 say, if I ascend into heaven, You are there. If I make my bed in Sheol, behold, You are there. If I take wings of the dawn, if I dwell in the remotest part of the sea, even there Your hand will lead me and Your right hand will lay hold of me. Let us sincerely desire the tangible presence of God in our Christian walk. Let Him know that we want to be up close and personal with Him. Amen. God bless you.